This is little baby Addie. She was born August 5th. Okay, I've got to adjust her just a little bit. Hold on. She's still in the show, isn't she? Did you see her little feet? Aren't they precious? Little Addie is such a good gift to us, and we are Gigi and Papaw. So I'm going to let Elaine come take her. You know, as a grandparent, you have to show them off and brag all the time. So, okay, is this your first pink night? Can I see your hand? Fabulous. Okay, let me introduce myself. I'm Debbie Morris. I know some of you are thinking, who is she? I am Pastor Robert's wife, and we've been married 33 years, but I also oversee all of the pink ministries at all of the campuses. And how many of you know what pink is? All right. Pink is a ministry to us women at Gateway Church. It encompasses a great deal. Everything from small groups. Shout out Mallory. Where is she? Small groups. to special events like tonight, a laugh, but also a conference every year called Pink Impact. Pink Impact, you need to start planning right now. We're going to have one here at the North Fort Worth campus. And ladies, I just want to brag on you for a minute. When we started planning this, we were thinking maybe 300 ladies would show up tonight, and you packed out the house. Congratulations. Way to go. Give yourself a hand. It's exciting what God is doing here at our North Fort Worth campus. You just keep impressing us over and over and over again. And you know, one thing about the North Fort Worth campus is Robert and I feel like we gave some of our very best people. Pastor Josh Morris, we think he is like the smartest, most intelligent, compassionate, kind, wise, capable young man. And he's here at the North Fort Worth campus. In case you don't know, that's our son. That's our oldest son. And he's part of the pastoral staff here. And we're so proud. We hear reports about you all the time. So that's a really, really good thing. But another way that I feel like that I sowed some of my very best, Chelsea Seaton. How many of you know Chelsea? Okay, you need to know Chelsea. Chelsea is one of the most fabulous young ladies in the world, in pinkdom. So we met Chelsea several years ago at a young women's retreat, and she was one of those ladies that we all came away very impressed with. She is a lot of fun to be with. She is a woman wise beyond her years. She is a woman who loves the Word of God. She is passionate about growing women and having fun at the same time. So when we started thinking about who would we want to put at the North Fort Worth campus to lead our women here, we thought of Chelsea. Now, Chelsea was dear to me because she's been my assistant for years. We had a lot of fun together, but that wasn't all she did. She did lots of other things. She worked in our event planning, so she understood all that it would require to put on an event like today. So I want to introduce to you a very special young lady. Will you please give a warm North Fort Worth pink welcome to Chelsea Seaton. I have great confidence that you are in good hands, and she is going to carry out the pink vision here at our North Fort Worth campus. So I want you to follow her leadership, and I want you to invest yourself in pink here. So how do you do that? You find her, okay? You find her, and you say, what can I do? Okay? And she will assign you a task. But, you know, we need all of you to get behind her and support her and continue to make events like this happen here at North Fort Worth. And with us doing Pink Impact here this year, she's going to need all of your help, okay? So I'm going to let Chelsea share a few things.
Right. Love you.
Love you.
Thank you.
Well, thank you, Pastor Debbie, so much. Can y'all... Pastor Debbie has a busy schedule, as you can probably imagine, and took time to drive here today and be with us tonight. So, Pastor Debbie, thank you. We're honored to have you at the North Fort Worth campus, as you called it. So that's really exciting to me to be a part of. I feel like I fit right in here, and so it's really great. So she's a little tired. It's all right. She's a little tired. Well, thank y'all so much. I am very excited to be a part of this campus. When we first in ministry staff meetings were talking about coming to this area, something leapt inside of my heart for this area. I grew up over here in North Richland Hills and actually lived right off Teal for about a year. And a dear friend of mine graduated from Fossil Ridge High School. And so this area holds a special place in my heart. And so when Pastor Debbie talked to me about coming over here, it was a no-brainer that I wanted to be a part of what God was going to do in this area. So I'm excited, and I can't wait for us to get started, and can't wait to see what God is going to do here. So two ladies I want to introduce to you that you'll want to know and that I want to honor tonight, because I think we have the dream team over here, is Pastor Debbie talked about Pastor Josh Morris. Well, I want to introduce Hannah Morris. Would you stand, Hannah? This is Pastor Josh's wife, and so I want y'all to know her, and she's a great asset to our team. And Lexa Burkeen is Pastor Marcus' wife. And Lexa, would you join me up here? So you probably know Pastor Marcus is our campus pastor, but Lexa is the better half. And the man you see up here, I know he is the man he is because this woman is right next to her. And I want y'all to know that we are spoiled rotten that we get Lexa Burkeen at our campus. We really are. She is the mother of 5 children. And you could look from afar and say, well, she homeschools all of them, and she's got 5, and they're perfect, and Proverbs 31. But this is the most genuine, wonderful person I have ever met, and it is an honor for us to get to have her here and watch her mother, her children, and be a companion and wife to her husband. So we are blessed to have her. And I've asked her to pray over our evening tonight, So, Lexa.
Thank y'all. Marcus and I really are honored to be leading over here at this campus. And I know there's some of you here that are visiting. I got some Facebook messages and tweets. And I just want to say welcome. We're so glad you're here. And if you don't have a church home, and you know, the Lord puts the lonely in families, and we'd love for you to come and join our family here. Let's pray. Father, we just thank you that you are a funny God and that you love to laugh. I can only imagine reading through the Bible and all those stories, how many times you laughed at your people. And so I think about when I hear my kids giggle or I hear the cackling laugh upstairs, that just brings so much joy and laughter to my own heart. So I just know that that's the way you look at us when we laugh. And that you love to laugh and you love to laugh with us. And so tonight we just invite your presence, Holy Spirit. We know that laughter is good medicine. And so we want to drink it all up tonight, Lord. We want your presence to come. We want you to manifest your work in us. And we just want to have a great time tonight, bonding with each other and having a great time together. We pray all this in the name of your son, Jesus. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lexa. Can y'all give Lexa one more? Awesome. All right, so let's get down to business. Who here had the worst day of your life ever in history? Bad. You came to laugh because the title of this event is Laugh and you needed to laugh. Let me see it. Let me see it. Okay. Oh, my hand's up. Sorry. Okay. So, no, I'm just kidding. So are you ready? Are you ready to laugh? Are you ready to have fun? Ready to enjoy it? All right. We'll take a look at this video, and then after that, we have an awesome performance that I know you're gonna love. Check this out.
Need to lift up that laugh. Y'all need to laugh.
Thank you.
movie tonight. The show was over when they turned on the light. We looked around and there was no one inside. Just baby and me.
You know, I was going to do the hula hoop thing, but I'm up here doing the MC thing, so I decided, okay, I'll let her do it. And I couldn't find my hula hoops, and, you know, it's just, I can't do it all, you know. And so, wasn't that incredible? Yeah. That's awesome. Well, I know we have some new people here, so it would not be a Pink Night if I didn't talk about Pink Impact, which is what the commercial you just saw there. Pink Impact is our annual women's conference, and how many here have been to Pink Impact? Would you say it's one of the best experiences, best conferences that you've ever been to? I realize that I could be a little biased since I'm on staff, but I attended Pink Impact before I was ever on staff, and it was life-changing to me. So, like Pastor Debbie said, we will have it at this campus. It will be $75 at this campus. It's going to be a live simulcast here. We will have some live creative elements here also. We'll have live worship. We get all the parties. We get all the gifts. It's going to be an awesome weekend. And, you know, it's actually, if you'll notice, it's on Mother's Day weekend. So my mom's here. Mom, come to Pink Impact with me. All right, great. Mother's Day weekend. We're doing it. So bring your moms. It's a great gift for them. All right, well, our comedian that I want to introduce, her name is Kristen Weber. She has performed at comedy clubs and churches and conferences all over the country. She writes for Sisterhood Magazine, which is a Christian publication for teen girls. And this is really exciting. I didn't want to forget the name of it, so I had to write it down. She wrote a book called The Smart Girl's Guide, a humorous advice book for teens. And it hits stores April 2014. And she is also performing next week with Tim Hawkins and Alan. So would you please welcome Kristen Weber.
Hey, guys. How's it going? You're having a blast, right? I am so happy to be here in Texas. It is by far my favorite country. Right? I actually just recently moved back to the DFW area from Hollywood, and you would not believe the crazy things that happen when you live out there. For example, this one time I was just like coming out of a Chipotle, and these paparazzi jumped out, and they started taking pictures of me. To make a long story short, if in May you guys saw a tabloid picture with a caption that read, "Anne Hathaway really lets herself go," that was me! Oh man, I did not fit in out in Los Angeles at all. Everybody there is tan. I'm Irish. I don't get to play that game. My friends stand outside for 10 minutes and they look like Malibu Barbie. I stand outside for 10 minutes and I have to get a biopsy. So I also learned when I was out there that I actually like to listen to rap music. But I don't want to fill my mind with all that filth, so I get the clean versions, which I don't know if you've ever listened to clean rap, but it's basically a bunch of angry men talking about their mothers. They're like, "Oh, your mother! Mother! My mother! Your mother!" We had very limited music choices when I was growing up because my parents did not want anyone brainwashing me. Except for them. So they homeschooled me. Do we have other socially special people here tonight? Oh my goodness. We could make up one public school classroom. And then all the rest of you guys were educated on the devil's playground. Yay! Oh, just so you know, that's a homeschool high five. We're gonna wait, they're just now getting it here. So we listened to mostly Christian music. A lot of it was acoustic, because as we all know, Satan lives in an amplifier. But I was actually over at my parents' house this weekend, and I was singing some song. I think it was like, All I Do Is Win. And I was like, and everybody's hands go up, and they stay there, and they stay there. You know it, and they stay there. And my mom was like, oh, is that a new worship song? I was like, in some places it is. We always request it when we go evangelizing in the clubs with my homies. Fool. Oh, I've only been clubbing one time. My friends don't let me go anymore. Because I guess I made the experience uncool. Here's what they told me, though. I'd never been clubbing, and they were like, I was like, what do you do? And they were like, you just dance. Like, you dance like you know how. And I was like, okay, right. And so the music starts. It's like, da-dun, da-dun, yeah. I'm like, I got this. Da-dun, da-dun, yeah. Da-dun, da-dun, yeah. Da-dun, da-dun. They were like, get Swan Lake out. It's not a compliment in a hip-hop nightclub. The same thing happens when I try to rap. I just end up sounding like a Disney character. I'm like, and when we get down in the clubs, all the girls, they be going, ah. I was actually not allowed to watch The Little Mermaid growing up. Not because there was witchcraft and sorcery, but because Ariel rebelled against her father and lived. So I am the second of five children, and all of my siblings have become these massive overachievers. Okay, so my older sister is a neonatal nurse who daily saves the lives of very small babies. My younger brother is a second lieutenant in the United States Air Force. Thank you. I will take that applause. I like to think that I trained him. I was like, tying you to a tree for 3 hours is not being mean. It is a drill that will later save your life. And then my first younger sister is a mathematical genius who just can't decide if she wants to accept the scholarship from MIT or Stanford for grad school. I was like, I totally understand your dilemma. I couldn't decide between Chipotle and Chick-fil-A for lunch. And then my youngest sister just started at the Air Force Academy, and she is double majoring in astronautical engineering and Chinese. Okay, the scariest thing about that is that for the first 18 years of her life, she had us all convinced she was an idiot. And so my dad told me he talked to her and she wants to be a spy in China. I was like, newsflash, she might already be a spy in China. But seriously, you guys, they are trying to make my life look like a joke. But I think I have them all beat. You see, because I teach music during the day and then do stand-up at night, which makes me like Hannah Montana. Pre-VMAs, Hannah Montana. Oh, man. Homeschooling was great, though. There was one thing that I would change about homeschooling. I don't think you should have to take sex ed from the people who conceived you. My mom told me that a lifetime of shame and regret starts with eye contact. So I know this is a women's event, but if there are any guys here tonight and I don't look directly at you, it is nothing personal, it is just I am not ready for a baby. So, big shocker, I'm still single. Which is no big deal in Los Angeles, but like, I'm living in the Bible Belt now. And my age in Southern Baptist years is like 90. And everybody is obsessed with like getting me married. Like even my dad, he won't show me how to change a flat tire. Cause he's like, well, Kristen, a flat tire is a great way to meet someone. I'm like, yeah, the person who's gonna murder me and bury my corpse in a field. And then somebody else was like, just make sure you find someone who makes you happy. And I'm like, well, I'm already happy. Can't I just marry someone who will make me rich? And then somebody else told me, they were like, you may want someone who's at least a little tan just so your kids aren't see-through. The all-time best advice I ever got, though, about like how to get a husband came from this lady who came up to me after a show one time. And she was like, okay, now I know you joke about it in your act, but is getting married something that you want? And I was like, yeah, sure, in God's timing, if he brings the right guy along. And she's like, no. If you're ready to get married now, here's what you got to do. She's like, you need to get a pair of man's pants, and you need to hang them on the end of your bed. And then you pray to God every single night to fill those pants with the perfect man. She wasn't done. She's like, but you're tall, so you need to get a big pair of pants so that you get a tall man. I was like, well, my dad's kind of tall. Can I just use a pair of his? And she was like, oh, no, sweetie. That's a little weird. She's like, just go to Goodwill and get a pair. I was like, I don't want a used man. Besides, I gotta think about this. Like, do I want a lawyer? Should I get designer pants? If I get skinny jeans, will I get a hipster? If I put a pair of football tights and a Bible at the end of my bed, will I get Tim Tebow? Anyway, she was so excited for me. She gave me her card and she was like, let me know how it goes. And I was like, I will email you when there is a man in my pants. It's like, that sounded different in my head. I gotta get out of here in a second. I do write for Sisterhood Magazine, and it's a Christian publication. It used to be Brio Magazine from Focus on the Family, if you've heard of that. But I have some free copies here tonight, so if you are a teenager or a parent of a teenager, I would love to meet you and give you a free copy. So I will leave you guys with this. This is a soprano ukulele. I think we can all agree it's adorable. I have this theory that you could say or sing anything to the tune of this instrument and it would make it sound happy. And I wrote a song to prove it. Earthquakes, tornadoes, and famine. I got food poisoning from salmon. While hurling out my guts, my boyfriend broke up with a text. Doot da doo, doot da doo. Puking and sobbing. North Korea is under new dictatorship. My great aunt fell and broke her hip. Just a word of advice, if you are old, try not to trip. Doot da doo, doot da doo. Bed sores and walkers. I ran over a turtle on my way home. For my birthday, someone gave me a garden gnome. What the heck kind of a gift is that? Have you guys seen those things? They are so creepy. Now I can't even go to bed at night because I'm afraid it's going to come alive and stab me in my sleep. Doot da doo, doot da doo. I'm really tired. There's lots of tragedy to keep me up at night, but I found a way to make everything all right. My ukulele makes the world so bright. Doot-da-doo, doot-da-doo, leeches and cancer. Doot, Dadu, dance break.
Yes, my ukulele makes the world so bright.
Do-da-do, perfect health is the slowest way to die. My name is Kristen Weber. You guys have been amazing. Thank you so much.
I think that when you're a mom, getting things done is a completely different story.
Okay, but let's be honest. Like, ever since I had kids, I'm a much better multitasker.
Yeah, I think it's probably a little easier to get things done because you're used to doing so many things at once. Don't you think?
I think people need to stop complaining about it being so complicated to work and be a mom. I mean, we're lucky to have kids, and if we don't enjoy the moments.
Yeah, it is. I think it's easier.
Yeah, it's easier.
Is that a child?
Coughing.
Jen. Hi, it's Kate. My seller is not about to come down in price. I got your email.
She is really about selling to the right person at the right price at the right time. And she is about to get a spanking if she doesn't take her diaper off.
Okay, well, you know, I can certainly understand that. You know what I mean? Because some people are very sentimental about their properties. But I know I can... You know, what if I do this?
No, I don't think there's anything you can do except
take the Lucy got in the tub when she was not supposed to.
Get up now.
That was just our initial offer. You know what I'm saying?
Okay, all right. You know, what if I do this?
What if I give you a number, say, 1, 2.
What?
I'm sorry. 6.
6.
Eat it.
You've got to be kidding me.
Okay, you know what? My client... That was our initial offer.
Wiggle room is great,
but what I really need you to do is get me an offer that is closer to the original selling price, okay?
Because then I can take it to my client. She's gonna be happy with what?
Who or he? Okay, go.
What? Don't you want the Barbie dream house?
What I want is I want your client to sell this property,
okay? So
what if we offer
7.85?
Really?
You know, a really quick
escrow and all cash. Do we have a deal?
Yes, we have a deal. Absolutely.
Oh, it really is the pleasure.
Working with you, Jen. You have no idea.
Oh, Kate.
You are one of the most professional agents in this industry, so I really, really appreciate it.
Okay, well, are you going to the meeting later?
You know, I am slammed here at work. I'm underwater on a couple projects, so I'm going to miss the meeting. Take care, okay?
Okay, I understand. All right, well, you have a great day then.
Okay, bye-bye.
Bye-bye.
Bullying. Let's chat about it. Talk. It's kind of the helicopter mom syndrome that I think is making the bullying problem bigger than it is.
Oh, it's because of helicopter momming?
Yeah, and momming. You have that look on your face because you're kind of you're feeling guilty right now.
Because I'm a helicopter mom.
Well, not in a bad way. I'm just saying.
I'm not a helicopter.
You little hovering.
You are like a drill sergeant with your 2-year-old.
I don't.
You're like shut it and eat it. Those are like the 4 words that you use.
Does my face do that?
Kind of.
Okay. I'm not.
No, I'm
kidding. I don't want to fight.
No, let's not fight. But
that if we don't hover, mm-hmm. and I'm not a drill sergeant, like neither of us do our thing,
right?
And we let them work it
it's
out.
It's like if they're bleeding, don't hover.
Right.
That's gonna make the problem worse.
And then I'm like, why?
Even there, bloody nose.
What did you do to deserve it?
Right.
That's what I'm saying.
Okay.
Don't get involved.
Don't get
where
involved.
We're not needed.
Okay, got it. Thank you.
So apparently, Kerri had a change of heart, and she is waiting behind a tree right now behind me to catch this bully that told her daughter that she wasn't pretty and didn't let her
sit.
Hey,
Kit, what's up? Oh, I am, aren't I? I like your hair. It's real pretty. You know what else is pretty? You know what else is pretty?
Clip from Kerri's new television show, Momland. It also features Angela Hoover, who, if you watch America's Got Talent, is a finalist on there right now. All right, are you guys ready for your headliner? Yeah! Well, you might have seen her on any one of her 29 appearances on The Tonight Show. Her book, Guys Like Girls Named Jenny, is currently being considered for a major motion picture, and she is also being seen right now on Nick at Night's Mom's Night Out. Would you guys please give a huge Texas welcome to Kerri Pomarolli?
What's up? Oh, look at my super Christians over there. That's right. These are the women that care. Those are the. Why is that row empty? Did they get raptured? What happened? That is awkward. This is like a church, and Jesus comes back, and he took like four people. That's. I blame the pastor. I don't know. Just kidding. How are you guys doing? You having fun? Happy to be out of the house? Okay, before I get started on my act, that was anybody watching America's Got Talent right now? Anybody? Do you recognize Angela? It's my girl. She's semifinals tonight. Angela Hoover, vote, vote, vote. Support clean comedy. She's an amazing, those, and, you know, we're working on the new show, Momland, so we're excited about that. And we're out in Sodom and Gomorrah. We're two of the four Christians out there. And so... Angela Hoover. So you guys, I am psyched to be here. I'm psyched to be anywhere. I don't know, did that look familiar to you? Anybody have a how? But I love it when we get to church, especially when it's all women. We have to put our Jesus face on. So we're so good. We're so good. We're just happy to be out of the house. So some of you left your children with babysitters or spouses. You'll be like, I'll be back next Monday. I don't know. We may go to Vegas. I don't know where the Lord's going to lead. I don't know. I need to be submissive to the spirits. Nobody had a house like that. Nobody. You're in the church. It's so good, right? And your phone ring. Excuse me, it's my husband. What? What? I am talking to big people right now. You understand me? Just go in the refrigerator and pick something and put it in their mouth. God is so good. I have no problems. Speaking of problems, if you guys like my shoes tonight, like my tennis shoes, I packed and I brought one shoe. Like, if you ever packed, it's not even a joke. And I was like, I'm performing for women. Why am I wearing high heels? Like, I don't care about you that much. I'm married. I'm not trying to pick anybody up tonight. I know there's guys here. There's like a few random guys scattered. Like, somebody's wife told them it was a monster truck tonight. There's always that one guy at the women's conference. He's like, one of these kids is not like the other. I see you back there. What's up? One guy's like, no, I'm just here to pick up chicks. It's good, you know. Playing the odds. Playing the odds. But those were my real children, my little tax write-offs in the show with me, so I'm very excited. I have two beautiful kids. I have a 5-year-old and a good one. Good one's two. We like her more. And... I wish you could meet them. They're in the car. But I like you guys. You don't judge me. I rolled down the window. It's not that hot. They'll text me. Come on. You know you like one of your kids better. And kids like you, if you're here with your mom tonight, it's you. You're the one they like. Because if you have only one kid, where are the parents here with one kid, right? These are the moms that care, okay? These are the ones, they read books, they go online when they're pregnant, they look how big their baby is, it's a grapefruit, whatever. And then you have the baby, and it's all organic, and you just said 2 years down the road, you screw it up so bad, you're like, I'm gonna start over, all right? And you just keep having kids. And you gotta feel sorry for those second kids that come along. They don't get stuff the first kid gets, like food, you know, they don't. Mama's tired, you know, brain cells have been sucked out of her. I'm telling you. And I mean, seriously, and it's, who is crazy enough to have the third kid? Nobody cares about the third kid. Is anybody here a third or a fourth kid in the pecking order? In the yeah, what are you in the blue sweater? You're third? Nobody even knows where you are. The third kid could be in Tijuana at Bible study, whatever. I didn't know they had pink night in Mexico. That's great. Just don't die. Whatever. The first kid is organic. The first baby doesn't watch TV. You know those moms? I was totally that mom. She didn't watch TV. She never had sugar. My second child came out of the womb. She's like, me amo, Dora, me amo, swiper, no swiping, swiper. I was like, I'm awesome. She's bilingual, all right? Please. I learned my lesson. I had her all good. She was organic, sugar-free, never saw TV. Then I did the dumbest thing any mother could ever do. I let my baby spend the weekend at grandma's house. Oh, no, no, no. Don't you clap, grandmas. You know you want that baby. You know you want, give me the baby, give me the baby. You know you want that baby because you want to pay your kids back for the teenage years, don't you? Give me the baby. Because you could screw up 2 years of parenting in 36 hours. This is the same woman that ran my childhood like a prison guard on lockdown, but now she's Nina. Nobody goes to bed at Nina's house. 9-month-old get Coca-Cola to settle her stomach. My kid's feet are like getting M&M. She's like, say my name. Nana loves you. Have a cupcake. Nana loves you. Mommy wouldn't give you this kind of love. No, she wouldn't. Don't tell. Okay. The kid was sugared up from the minute she got to grandma's house to the minute she left. She watched TV from the minute she got to grandma's house to the minute she left. She comes home to my house. She's like a crack addict in rehab. She didn't know her name. We're at the bank, you know? And I pull out my mommy's medicine, my M&Ms, right? And she looks and she goes, this candy, mama, I need it, mama. And I'm right next to her going, no, I need it. Give it back. You little whippersnapper. So much like many churches, they ask us to leave. And I get home and she sees the TV. She's like, I watch TV for 47 hours. How does she learn to talk like that? Her father, that's how. I watch TV. I'm like, what do you want to watch? You know, Scooby-Doo? She's like, no, General Hospital. Look at Laura. So I put her in timeout, because I'm a timeout. I really am. I believe it's 1 minute of timeout for every minute I've been alive. And, right? And I think that moms, we got to give ourselves credit. We got to, like, relax. And I wanted to do something spiritual on my mommy time. So I was watching Real Housewives of Orange County. And, okay, let's pretend you're not watching it. All right, anyway. You know you are. We love to judge people. We're Christian. And Kristen said it first. Brilliant girl. So my husband comes home, you know, and like they don't know how hard we've been working all day. And don't we need like some kind of sign? I'm like, this is my dance space. This is your dance space. You don't touch me. I'm watching my show. Okay? I'm watching my show. And he gets all, and you know when they start talking like your kids, you know what I mean? He's like, cuddle. And I'm like, are you kidding me? Not today. Okay? Go to timeout. All right? Go. I don't believe in spanking your kids in public. Where you can get caught. I don't. And I remember when I only had one kid, I never would have spanked her. And I remember my pastor was like, we don't spank our kids. We use a wooden spoon. I was like, what? They're like, because it's not us doing the spanking, it's the spoon. And I was like, whatever. Okay, and I never would have spanked her. She was perfect until one day she took Maybelline mascara and she fingerprinted all over my white kitchen cabinets. And I turned into my mother. Have you ever had that moment where you turn into your mother? And I looked at her and I was like, I'll get you, my pretty, and your little dog too. So I went to grab a wooden spoon, but I wasn't fast enough. She was jetting behind the couch. So all I could get was an icing spreader with cake, you know, a cake icing spreader. So I'm chasing her behind the couch and she's like, that's for cooking. That's for cooking. And my husband's like, how would you know? Nobody cooks in this house. Yeah, great. So I never touched her. I was just going to chase her around the house and threaten her so she'd become a comedian and have issues. But I mean, seriously. So the next day at preschool, she's like, I love you, Mommy. Will you please not hit me with the knife again? It's like, don't worry about it, baby. Mommy's going away for a long time. Back to prison where you met Daddy? I don't like kids that talk. So I like the two-year-old. She didn't give me much problems. I really like her. Because, you know, when you're the younger sibling, you're just trying to survive. You know what I'm saying? But I did have one bad experience with my sweet two-year-old. We flew all the way from Atlanta to Los Angeles. And that baby cried for 4.5 hours straight, nonstop screaming bloody murder. And the woman next to me, her strategy was give me dirty looks the entire flight. I'm sorry, I gave birth. I'm sorry, you know? And so finally, at the end of the flight, I had it. And I was like, look, lady, if you're so perfect, what would you do different? And she's like, well, first of all, I would take the baby out of the overhead. We're in a recession, ma'am, okay? I am going green, all right? Now, I know we're in the South, and I always meet these women at my Southern conference. They're like, you know what I do? I like to give my babies a little NyQuil and a little Benadryl. Where are you? Where are you? Where are you, you little drug dealers? Where are you? At least you're honest. The rest of them are lying. You know the problem starts at home, okay? I'm just saying I would never drug my child. I would do what my grandma did and give the baby a little Jack Daniels, but we still do that. But I love being a mom. It's the five-year-old is, she's what we like to call spirited, okay? And you know the code, active. If you're a teacher, that means crazy. And so I knew it. I knew she was gifted from the time I could see it on the ultrasound. And so I knew she was going to go to Harvard. And when she was a baby, we put her in church childcare, which is not a good idea, not a good idea. And so we put her with the average babies, and they would crawl up to my daughter and force their flesh into her mouth and make her bite down on them. Because they were jealous of her. You know, they wanted some of that, you know. And I don't like it. And I don't like when they give your kid a number. You ever drop your kid off and your kid becomes 232? How does a pastor think you're going to focus on his sermon? You don't care. You're just playing bingo going, don't call 232. Don't call 232. The Lord is my what? Don't call 232. And if you're the parent of a predator, if they call 231, what are you thinking? What did my kid do to 231? What did my kid do? You know what I'm talking about. And I don't like the churches with the pager. You know the churches, they give you a pager, and if your kid's trying to eat someone, they call you out of the service. And this one church got really legalistic because they were mad because I didn't respond to the pages in time because my husband and I were at a movie. We dropped her for Saturday night service, and we picked her up on Monday morning, and she was so filled with the Lord, and it's all good now because we've discovered preschool. It's awesome. Love her. She's in a 7-day-a-week program. It's 9 hours, and we are looking forward to overnight kindergarten and here in Texas. But I don't want to talk about mom stuff and marriage and all that stuff. Where's my single girls at? Where's my, woo! Right, these are the ones that have energy. I know, look at they're like, woo, we're going to stay up past 9:30. We're going to do it, woo. We're going to run with scissors, yes. I love my single girls. I had a ministry for a long time. I don't want to sell out on you guys. I didn't mean to go to the dark side, but I had a ministry. I was singles ministry. It was called Bitter Party of One. And I was kind of an angry single. And it didn't help that my mother is very Southern and very Southern. Do you have any, like Alabama, Georgia, like really like super Christian, more Christian than anyone ever? Okay, that's my mother. Like, she's super Christian. She quit her church choir when they added a tambourine. Okay, so. I know, there's some people in here. Well, she should. We should. So, when you have a daughter in the deep South, and she's still single, and she's over the age of 9, that is a terminal disease, right? That's when they start having prayer circles for my mother down in her church, down in Alabama. They're like, all right, everybody, we're going to lay hands on Sister Barbara again. Dear Lord, her daughter's out in California. She's still single and alone. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to cast out the demons that are keeping her from getting a husband. Can I hear an amen? I was like, Mother, those demons are called taste and good standards, okay? So stay strong, single girls. Don't sell out and don't marry for love. That's stupid. Don't. Trust me on that one. No. Marry for old money, okay? There's got to be some oil wells around here. I'm telling you. Right? And, I mean, dating's tough in California. They don't have Southern boys. They don't have chivalry. Okay, it's all equal rights and stuff. And I hate that. I mean, I was on this date, okay, and the check comes. It's the first date, right? Girls, what do you do on the first day? The check comes. I was like, let me get that. And he let me get that, you guys. That is ghetto, okay? Or inappropriate. I don't know. Whatever you want to call that. And boys, you don't take a girl to the movies and you buy the tickets and she buys the popcorn. Popcorn costs $957, Skippy. We just put $500 to look natural for you, okay? This takes a village, honey. And they better like it on the first date, right, girls? It's not getting any better. Let me tell you. And my girlfriends were like, you need to work out if you want to get a man. Now, I have family from the South. We didn't work out growing up, okay? We drove to get the mail. You know, I mean, my mother never made dinner. She made reservations. God bless her. And so I didn't know what this working out thing was, but after a few years of being single, I'm like, okay, I'll try. So I was single, out in LA, not married, and I go into this workout class, and 5 minutes into this aerobics class, I start bleeding. I am bleeding, okay? And I look in the mirror, and there's this clear drops of blood dripping from my forehead, just like all over my body. It was so gross. It's a disease. I Googled it on WebMD. It's called perspiration, and you don't want it. If you're single, you don't want it. If you're married, who cares? You know, and so I decided to go to this other class, and I was in it for 3 years. It was called prenatal yoga, and I loved it. I loved it, except the girls were jealous of me. Every week, they were more jealous. They're like, when are you due? And I was like, do what, honey? I'm the skinniest one in here, okay? You've gained 40 pounds since we started this class. Why aren't you stretching? I don't know. So guess what? They asked me to leave, you know? And then I tried the dumbest class you could ever try. Has anyone here ever tried the Zumba? Really? Is there any blonde people like me that just clap for that? Because, yeah, sweetie, we don't belong in the Zumba class. You didn't get the memo either? Yeah. You need to have an inner Latina. You need to have an inner J-Lo or an inner Charo for the old people, okay? I know. I just lost the whole front row, all these young girls. They're like, what's a Charo? Don't you eat that? They're all on Twitter right now. Charo, you guys. You know you're old when people have to Google my act. But So I don't belong in Zumba. And the teacher is so sexy, you know, and they're always in these like little short shorts. And they're like, shake what your mama gave you. Shake what your mama gave you. I'm like, my mama gave me sciatica and allergies, okay? How do you shake self-esteem issues? You know? That's okay, because I found the greatest class of all time, and I'm still in it today. It's called Yoga for Senior Citizens. And all we do is lay there the whole hour. Then we go to the buffet. Grandkids eat free. I know. I love it. I love you, my seniors. I love you, but I'm going to out you guys tonight. I'm going to out you because you know what? I just did a show at a senior citizen assisted living community, and they let me behind the gates, and I spent the night, okay? And let me tell you something. Seniors have been holding out because I spent one night, and I called my mama, and I said, you need to get me some assisted living right now. Now is when I need it. I got two kids. I need assisted living. Why do we need to wait till the kids are out of the house? We need it now. I'm telling you, they have the bomb stuff. I'm never staying at a Hilton again. Assisted living, they got this big yellow cord. Singer girls, you'd love this. If you yank it really hard, all these good-looking doctors come running in the room. Awesome. They will bring you whatever you want, like, you know, Krispy Kreme donuts and a defibrillator, whatever. Their phone number, it's legal, they have to. And I love seniors, but I figured you guys get all the good stuff. My mother's, she's 73 now, and she gets to have a 10% off coupon at TJ Maxx every Tuesday, because she's a senior, and she gets to eat lunch for half price, because she eats at 10 a.m., and so I told my husband, I need assisted living. He's like, no, baby, you need attention, is what you need. So we got me OnStar for my car so I could have somebody to talk to every day. Which I thought was great until she blocked me. And, that's not friends. I know people ask me, why do you become a comedian? And I moved to Hollywood and I got to be on such godly shows like General Hospital and Young and the Restless. And I know you all recognize me. I was Nurse Kathy, the mute nurse on General Hospital. Because I was on it for so long and I never had a really big part, so I told my mom my character was mute. And so, and I remember, they're like, why are you a comedian? I'm like, isn't it obvious I didn't make cheerleading? And so I'm always kicking because I'm thinking somebody out there will pick me for their squad. And it's not good. It's not good. But I remember when I moved to Hollywood, I was like, Lord, I am a Christian, and when I win my Academy Award and marry Matt Damon, I'm going to say your name, Jesus. I'm going to come out of the closet. I'm going to do it. And God was like, well, thank you, Kerri, because I really need the PR. Thank you for that. And I remember when I did my very first Jay Leno episode, I was in my dressing room, and in the dressing room next door was the one and only Matt Damon, ladies. Matt Damon, you got to pray, okay? I name it and claim it. Matt Damon, Matt Damon, Matt Damon, Matt Damon. But you got to keep praying. I didn't understand. You need to keep praying that because, you know, that was a beautiful day. That's the day I got my very first restraining order. And because Matt had not heard from the Lord the way I had. But the cop had, so that's when I started my prison ministry. Hey, when I was doing that, my mom's like, why are you so picky? At least you know where he is at night. I'm telling you. I remember when I got to call my mother down in Georgia. I'm like, Mama, I finally found the one. I'm going to get married, Mom. And she's like, well, praise God. We've been praying for so long. And see, a pastor, Kerri. I said, no, Mama, better. Doctor? I said, no, Mama, he's a comedian. Hello? Hello? No, just breathe. Listen to me, Mom. Listen, he's half Korean and half Irish. You know what that means? Our kids will go to any college they want. We're fine. And my husband is the most amazing breeder. He is Korean, Irish, and 1/16th Native American. Woo! My kids are getting a scholarship and a casino. God is so good. My mother was very happy. Very happy. And, you know, she is such a Christian lady. And I love taking her all around the country. She's, you know, my mother's choir, they don't exactly exert themselves. They're Presbyterians. And she's like, they don't call us the Frozen Chosen for nothing. And so their choir is special. They sing so high that only small animals can hear them. And my mother always goes for the solo. She's not even in the choir, and she always goes for the solo. You know that woman? She's like, how great thou art! And you can hear God going, not so great, Barbara, not so great. Why don't you just stay home and watch Dancing with the Stars, okay? We don't need you. So I love taking her because she like never, they worship on the inside, you know, and so she never moves, ever. It's great to do comedy at my mom's church. I've actually done a whole comedy conference, and they don't laugh. They just nod at you, and they go. And then after it, they're like, that was crazy. I need to repent, you know. And some of you are laughing because you know Presbyterians. But it was great. I got to host part of the Gospel Music Awards a few years ago. I was at the Grand Ole Opry, and it was amazing. Amy Grant was there, and Kirk Franklin was there, and all these amazing artists were there. And we were in the back, and the music was pumping, and I saw my mother, and she was going like this. And I was like, Barbara, what? Did you just get healed? She was going like this. And she's like, well, I didn't go to Curves today, so I was multitasking during the worship. Shout to the Lord. You've done it, some of you. I have a story to tell. It actually did happen to me. It's a true story about I was in Texas, and I was in a church that was rather kind of a large church, and I was coming down to the front row, and, you know, the front row, these are the people that are, you know, the most Christian out of all of you. And so, what's up, heathens in the back? We'll go to a movie. Okay. They're the ones that are like, we could leave. Okay, so you know, if you're in the front row, you have to have everything already, like, done. You can't make any adjustments. Everyone's staring at you in the back. It's all got to be adjusted. And I just want to be, it's us girls here and these three guys. But I just want to know, has this ever happened to you? Have you ever been in worship and, like, in the front of a church and you realize that your undergarments have gotten themselves to a place that is hindering your worship? And you only have one song to literally work it out. You know what I'm saying? And you better hope it's like a charismatic church. You better hope it's like, there's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. There's no God like Jehovah. Woo, Holy Spirit. Woo. Woo. Because if it's like, how great thou art, that would be awkward. How great thou art. I'm sorry, that was the wrong show. I'm so Christian. Oh, see, they bring me into the church to make you guys feel better about your faith. There's the ministry we were praying about. Hey, I thought I had it bad. Not really. Mm-mm. You're a pillar compared to that girl. I was kind of the weird one. You know how you have like three kids and two of them are normal and then you have the third one. See, it's always the third one. And you lay your head at night and you're like, God, two out of three is not bad. My mother dropped me off in California. She's like, you're going to end up in church with Tom Cruise. I know it. Have them sign this t-shirt, you know, and because I was all about me. And I remember the first time my girlfriend, she invited me to church. She was like, come down to church with me. I was like, why? And she's like, this is a true story. She's like, we have potluck dinners. And I was like, potluck dinners, kumbaya, my Lord, you know. And I walked into the church. It was so weird. The pastor had a Hawaiian shirt on. I knew it was from the devil. And I had blue jeans, and they were swaying. I'm like, oh, this is a cult. Don't drink the Kool-Aid. Because it didn't look like church. I grew up, my father was a Detroit Yankee Italian Catholic, and he married a Southern Alabama Presbyterian, and they sent me to Dutch Christian Reform School. Dream big, okay? So, but I was there for the deviled eggs, you know? And so I remember them swaying to this music, and I stayed awake for the whole sermon, which I had not done before, and I really liked it. And I really felt like he was talking just to me. I'm sure my mother had called him and given him her sermon points as she does every week at her church. And but sometimes you come to something and it's in a church and it's just not what you think. You know, I had my Laura Ashley on and my Pearls for Jesus. And I was looking for the stained glass windows and there was no pews. It was chair pews. I'm like, how are we going to genuflect? And, you know, it was just this crazy thing. But I got my chicken, you know, and I was so happy. And then I came back the next week because if you feed them, they will come, you know. And I just kept coming back. And they liked me. They liked me so much. And they wanted me to come back on Wednesday nights because if you're really Christian, you go twice a week. And I'm like, oh. But I didn't want to go. I didn't want them to get into my life. I mean, Sundays I could do it. I could be really Christian on Sunday mornings. I didn't want them to know about Saturday night. You know, I was out, you know, fellowshopping and dance ministry. Woo. And I still got it. Take that, Miley. Woo. Okay, so anyway. This is the right way to do that. So the thing was, is I kept coming and I kept coming and I kept coming and I remember that there was just something inside of me that if I just kept showing up, something inside of me was changing day after day and week after week. And I just want to encourage you guys, just a quick little encouragement. Somebody dragged you here, your crazy coworker, your mother-in-law, your sister. Somebody's like, we're going to a comedy night. It's at a church. Don't worry about it. You know, and or it's in Texas. It's like still legal to go to church here. So. But something brought you here. Somebody brought you here, and I really believe that there's a divine appointment just being here, and the laughter is healing, and that God does have something for everybody that showed up here tonight. He's got laughter for you. He's got joy. Some of you forgot even how to laugh because you have kids, and because that's the most joyful time of your life. I've never threatened to kill someone so many times, and I love you. But whatever it is that brought you here, this is a place that wants you to come back. And this is a people, the group of people that put these nights together because they want you to come here and experience a great time. Because if I know anything about Gateway, you guys like to party. You know what I'm saying? It's a good, it's always a good time at Gateway. So, and I just kept showing up and God, it's like, I love Joyce Meyer said this. She says, you do what you can do and God will do what you can't do. And all he wanted me to do was just get up on Sunday morning and show up. And I kept doing it and my life started to change. And then I realized that I had a calling in life and I got rid of all that shame and regret and all those things that weren't perfect about me. And I said, God, I really want to serve you. I want to serve you with my whole heart. I want to do the craziest thing. I want to do ministry. And he's like, yeah, okay, so go back to Hollywood. I'm like, to the land of fruits and nuts? Are you cray cray? I just got out of there. I'm not going back there. God wanted me to do stand-up comedy. That's how I got into it. I was like, this is insane. That's not a ministry. He said, yes, it is, baby, because you got a big mouth and a dysfunctional family, all right? You can show people what I can do, you know? And so little by little, baby step, baby step, baby step, I just kept saying yes to God. If he tells you to do something insane, take a leap. Do it. Do it. Serve somewhere. Go do something that makes you uncomfortable because that's where God can really show up. And years later, my mom is in her living room watching me on CNN News in front of 440 million people, I think, and I'm a hand raising, wave my hand, I love Jesus Christian, in Hollywood. And she looked at me and she looked at God and she said, oh, Lord, look at my daughter raising her hands. I prayed too hard. See, that's the problem with prayer. It works. So just let that be an encouragement to you who's got something on your heart, especially those moms out there. You got the weird one. The weird ones are the most fun. And so are there any other weird ones here tonight? Anybody? Yeah, there's four of you and the rest are lying. Okay, good. But I am excited, and I remember when it was time for me to get married, I went to my pastor and I said, how do I be a godly wife? I heard about the intro. Some of you are just the perfect woman. And of course, what did they say? You need to be the Proverbs 31 woman. Yes, the Proverbs. I'd never read that chapter. And so He's like, read the chapter and be the Proverbs 31 woman. So, all right, I'm like, I'll read the chapter. So I read the whole chapter in the Bible, Proverbs 31. And let me tell you some Texas, that did not speak to me at all. I'm sorry. I did not receive it. I just crossed it out. I was like, I don't rise early and I don't plow, all right? Anyone? The only reason she was up early because she had like 30 kids and 14 jobs. She's trying to get a shower, you know? It said she gathers her food from afar. I was like, that's takeout, Jesus. That's Chinese food from the East. So I appreciate all those Proverbs 31 women out there, but I'm never going to be a Proverbs 31. So I started my own ministry. It's very spiritual. It's called the Proverbs 32 woman. And this says, she rises late and her kids make her breakfast. Yeah? Your mom? You need it? See what happens when you sit in the front row for Jesus? Do you have kids? One kid. Oh, you care. You're so perky. Look at you. I bet you showered this week, didn't you? Yeah, give it back. No, so I have this other shirt because I caught my mother talking to her friend about another friend, and I love it when I catch my mom in sin. And I was like, I busted you, Barbara. You can't talk about issues like that. That is ridiculous. That is sinful. She's like, that's where you're wrong, baby, because we are Christians. We don't have issues. We have prayer requests, okay? I was just asking her how to pray, all right? Because I'm name it and claim it, and I need names to claim. That's all. I'm like, you need therapy, Barbara? She's like, I don't need therapy. I have my small group. Because what happens at small groups stays in the church newsletter. Oh, no, not the one they hand out at church. The one that goes around on Facebook, okay? That one. So this is dedicated to all you small group ladies out there. It says, remember, it's not gossip if your head is bowed. Oh, whoever it landed, you must be struggling. Okay, good for you. So I brought some DVDs with me. I brought my book. This is Guys Like Girls Named Jenny. We wrote the screenplay for this, and we've been shopping it around to studios, and somebody asked me, why would you write a book about all your ex-boyfriends? And I think it's a really special book because I used all their real names. And you never know, could have been one of your husbands, we're not sure. And it's like a read-along adventure. And they're dubbing it like the Christian Bridget Jones, and it's been looked at by Sony Studios to become a motion picture. And if you guys know how to pray, you will see me and Matthew McConaughey on screen together. Don't pray wrong. Don't pray wrong. Don't pray like Ben Stiller or anything weird. So I'm going to give this to my, were you my single girlfriend? Yeah. Okay. So, sweet. Okay. And I have some DVDs. My husband and I, we did a DVD, Two Comics Walk Into a Church. And all the proceeds from our sales tonight go to my charity, Feed the Children. My children. Yeah, you better clap and buy something. And all the scarves are made, these are handmade scarves out by my mother, Barbara, and it's very important to her that I sell her wares. And because she'll call me after every show, how was it? I'm like, well, Jesus came, and, four people got out of wheelchairs. Did you sell my scarves? You know? I'm like, the Holy Spirit showed up. Was he wearing a scarf? You know, so... I have this DVD, and this I'm really proud to be a part of this. This is a documentary film. It's called Hollywood on Fire, and there's lots of different celebrities that are Christian in this, and one of the celebrities that is awesome is the late actress Jane Russell. She was a believer. She took Marilyn Monroe to Bible study. She witnessed to Howard Hughes. She did some amazing things, and this is a documentary that will hopefully keep you guys encouraged to pray for us. out there and on the battlefield. So please, you want that? Okay, yeah, it's good. You ask and you shall receive. Okay. What's your worst sin? Did you see how fast she ran? She's like, oh my gosh. My mother called. We don't have that kind of time. I'm sorry. But come see me afterwards. If you've got something on your heart you want to pray about, I love to pray. If you've ever, you know, has anyone been to any of my other Gateway shows? Yeah. We do a lot of praying and a lot of crying. But, you know, we talked about it backstage. We just want to laugh and we just want to give you guys joy. But please do not leave tonight. Don't leave. Find me. Find one of these amazing ladies. Get with somebody and say, I had some stuff before I walked in the door, and I don't want to leave with it because I'm not going home until everybody gets prayer because I don't want to go home. Because I like it here. And I'm going to go to my hotel and jump on the bed and watch cable. Thank you. But, you know, and I, things have been kind of, you know, interesting. I've been married for 8 years to my husband now, same guy. And we recently were like decided we need to go on more dates, you know, spice it up. So we both joined eHarmony. Don't judge me. My whole profile was like, I just want a man who can fix a sink. That's all I want. My husband's profile is like, I just want a man who can fix a sink. I know all the single girls are like, I don't get that one. I don't. You will. But I love you guys. I had kind of a little thing, and I thought I would just share something so you won't feel alone if you're struggling in your marriage. I had a little altercation with my husband recently, and It was right after Memorial Day this year, because you know we're Southerners, right? So after Memorial Day, we're allowed to wear white, and if you wear white before, you go to hell. So, anyways, so I was so excited, you guys. I got this amazing. Do you love it? I got it at Ross, and so I got this amazing like white pantsuit and the white tank top, and it was just awesome. Right? And I had my shoes and my hair, and he was driving me, and we're going to this amazing women's conference, and I'm rocking my white because you know I wanted to look holy and pure and stuff, and so. So I'm like, hey, let's go. And he takes one look at me, and he looks at me, and I'm like, what? He's like, you're not wearing that. And I was like, what? And I kind of turned into like an angry, like, you know what I'm saying? I was like, what? He's like, you're not wearing that. I'm like, are you talking to me? Okay? Somewhere between like an angry Latina and Joe Pesci. You know what I'm like? Are you talking to, what do you mean I'm not wearing that? He's like, Kerri. I'm like, what? He can't even talk. He's like, oh. I'm like, what's the problem? He's like, the shirt. I'm like, what are you talking about? He's like, the shirt you're wearing. No, you guys understand this. You ever buy the cute little tank top shirts and they have like the built-in bra and you can't wear a regular bra because if your bra strap shows, you go right to hell. So you guys know what I'm talking about. The three guys deal with it. Okay, so. He's like, you can't wear that because, you know, it's too thin. I'm like, what are you talking about? The shirt is too thin. He's like, if there's a breeze, it won't be a Christian conference, okay? Whatever, Mr. Morality Police. I'm like, whatever. He's like, you can't wear that. And I mean, I knew I was going to win this. So I just had to take a moment and pray. I was like, Lord, you got to give me something because you gave me this outfit on sale. I know it was from you. I got to wear it. And so I walked in, and bam, the Lord reminded my friend Gina. She was in the Miss America pageant, and what they used to do, they were very biblical. When they had certain issues of modesty in the Miss America pageant, they would take strategically placed Band-Aids, and they would solve the problem of what we're talking about, okay? I'm in a church. They placed biblically placed Band-Aids, 1, 2, and now we're Christian again, okay? So... So I go back out, I was like, hasta la vista, let's go. And he's looking at me and he looks horrified. I'm like, what's your problem? I just beat you. And he's like, I'm like, what? He's like, they're too small. I was like, oh, I'll be right back. So I'm not giving up. I'm not a quitter. And I got 2 more Band-Aids and I made a cross, okay? Right? What would Jesus do? So now I'm super holy and I won, because that's what matters in marriage. Winning. Better to be happy than right. No, you're right, okay? It's better to be right and happy, okay? So you'll clean that up next Sunday. Okay, so I come out, I got my cross. I'm like, let's go. He's like, that is not cross your heart, brah. This is ridiculous. I am your husband, and you got to, I'm like, what? He's like, you got to submit to me. I was like, oh, you submit to this. I'll tell you. You don't tell me to submit. You pull that up. He's like, I am your husband, and I'm the leader of this house, and I'm going to go downstairs, and you better come out with something appropriate right now. And then he ran as fast as he could, right? And now I'm mad. Now I'm really mad. I'm like, Lord, you got to get me out of this. You got me into this. And you got to give me a holy idea. And there it was. I opened it up. And I go to the cabinet in the bathroom. And ooh, I look and there's the box. These huge, beautiful, honking square Band-Aids, girls. Just my size, baby. One, two, buckle my shoe, okay? Winning. Woo! I felt good. I felt empowered. I felt awesome. I felt hot. I felt hotter. I felt burning. Burning. Fire. Fire. I went over the sink and I rinsed myself off and I got the box and it said medicated menthol pain patches. So even though it was in May, I went and I got a turtleneck sweater and I went downstairs and I submitted to my husband. God bless you guys. Thank you. Thank you, thank you, thank you.
Thank you so much, Kerri. That was awesome. Whew. Let's all pray for her chest right now in Jesus' name. Wow. Well, have you had fun tonight? All right. Well, I've got good news. You don't have to go home yet because we have an after party outside in the lobby for you with desserts and soft pretzels that are delicious. I taste tested everything to make sure, because I love you, women. I love you, and I will not let you eat something that is nasty. So I had to take 2 or 10 of everything. So you're welcome. All right, and I want to let you know that our next Pink Night is October 24th. Right here, come back. We'd love to see you. And also register for Pink Impact, pinkimpact.com. And Pink Groups, we have an awesome privilege tonight. The Pink Group pastor, Mallory Bassham, is here with us tonight. And so she will be out in the lobby at the information booth to answer any questions you have about Pink Groups. And she's also going to fill you in on the block party, which is September 9th. If you're interested in getting in a group, knowing about groups, this is the thing to come to. It's September 9th at the Southlake campus. And we have some awesome MCs. And so you should be there. I may or may not be one of them. So you can just come to support me. That'd be great. Thank you. And also, we have Women of Worth in the lobby as well. This is our widows ministry. So we have two really exciting groups out in the lobby that if you'd like more information about them, you can do that. I also want to say thank you to our amazing volunteers who worked on all the decor out here. Would you give them a round of applause? Yeah. We've got an incredible volunteer team, and if you would like to volunteer, you can email me, and I'd love to help you get plugged in. I'll be down here. I'd love to meet you if you're new here, and shake your hand, and I'm so glad that y'all were here tonight. Thank you for coming. Let me bless you, and then we'll get out to the after party, all right? Lord, thank you so much for these women, God. Thank you for the honor to serve them, Lord. I pray that tonight they would be encouraged, that they would leave feeling your love around them, and God, that they would be safe as they go and that they would meet lots of people in the lobby tonight and leave feeling connected to you and to each other. In Jesus' name, amen. See y'all. Good night.